associated with Bilcare since last 10 years. In fact, I started my career with Boots Pharma, moved to Knoll, and then was with Abbott. Total tenure of around 25 plus years in this industry. To tell you about Bilcare, Bilcare is an Indian multinational having its base in India and offices in US, UK, Singapore with 30 depots for investigation and product management and 12 factories for films and foils. It's a listed company in Bombay Stock Exchange with a group turnover of around $400 million. The topic, in fact, as Mr. Ashok did ask me about globalization with respect to packaging, maybe the area which I represent is clinical supplies. But of course, when I started my career with Boots Pharma, I remember those days the industry was not very regulated, not organized. Like now, as the volume started increasing, we had to ship to automatic machines were bought in to cater to the increasing volumes. So in that connection, I remember material handling systems, granulation areas, high speed compression machines and strip pack machines were converted to blister pack machines to cater to the need. And of course, being from that era of maybe 25, 30 years back, they will endorse me. Those were the days of unions. You know, unions were very, when I say unions, it was with respect to labor union. They were very strong. It was not very easy for us to stabilize the production. But thanks to then our HR team, human relations, and government policies, and we could set the process in line. And government also, encouraged to set up plants like excise-free zones were created in Goa, maybe Sikkim, Baddi, and that's how we could achieve all the increased volumes. And today, I really feel great to say that every third tablet, which is being consumed in US, is manufactured in India. Every fifth patient who's being treated in US is by an Indian doctor. Moreover, out of 18 team of doctors for US president, 13 doctors are from India. That's really indeed a pride for us. And India is the largest exporter for generics today. And not to say that after USA, we are the largest country to have US FDA approved plant in India. That's indeed is a paradigm shift with respect to our pharma industry. Over to
Pradeep, you would like to throw some light?
Yeah, good afternoon, friends. I'm Pradeep Dhargalkar, in industry for now more than 35 years. Let me at outset thank Pharma Gorilla and all stalwart speakers who spoke on the various aspects of pharmaceutical industry. The only left out point perhaps is the one for which we all of us are sitting. When sir asked this question, and I remembered his words today morning, who are we? Who are we meaning? Who are the packaging development or packaging technologists? We are the people who are going to create image of your product in national and international market. With due respect to my formulation development team, definitely you people had done all the efforts in developing the product. Maybe it is solid oral dosage forms, injectable, large volume, parenterals, ointments, and so many other reforms of pharmaceutical industry. But what it lies on the pharmaceutical packaging development team is perhaps the vital parameter. As sir has asked the question on globalization and what are the latest trends, I take that privilege of saying that Unichem was the first pharma industry to introduce in domestic market. Remember my words. What today we are talking about DGFT, anti-counterfeiting, European Union's falsified medicine directive, which is known as EUFMD. Or for November, we have implemented on Drug Supply Chain Security Act on our medicines getting exported to US. But remember, in domestic market, we were the one to create what is known as MAS, M-A-S. I could read only these words over a period of industry in only Drugs and Cosmetics Act. M stands for misbranding, A for adulteration, and third one, S for spurious. But the same terminology what we are adopting in pharma industry for track and trace is known as mobile authentication service. Is your product, when sir you said today morning, in pharma industry your end user is a customer, is a patient, is a senior citizen, is a doctor, or he is a pharmacist. I say in packaging, packaging material, packaging is a 9-letter word. I'm not going to elaborate what it means. But when I talk about packaging, the whole concentration goes on how authentic that packaging is. So to give to my end user a genuine authentic product is the responsibility. And that too also in concurrence with all the stakeholders. So with 2D barcoding and EU-FMD directives, I think Indian pharma industry has really superseded the rest of the world, India in particular, in taking the lead in exporting their medicines in number of countries. That's what my personal approach on globalization.
Prabir, your views on...
This is Prabir Das from Mylan, heading the packaging technical services. With my 32 years experience in packaging, in fact, what I observed, there is a sea of changes happened. In earlier days, we used to see medicines are dispensed from doctor's dispensary by mixing the ingredients using crucibles and all those things. Then putting into a bottle, adding water, making it up to mark, and then putting some paper sticker cut nicely. And that is the kind of area I have seen in my childhood. Then I was never knowing that what really packaging is. I joined a course started by Indian Institute of Packaging in Mumbai in the year 85 when they started this post-graduation course in packaging. So that is my first entry in this particular area, and I saw a very passionate subject where arts, commerce, science, all are mixed together. And then no product is sold in the market without packaging. We don't want our kids, whether it is a boy or girl, or whether normal, black or fair, or whatever it is, they cannot go out of the home without having the dresses. So whatever effort you put into the product, you cannot go to the market without the packaging. Your product may be having 90% value, but that 10% value what packaging adds, that actually makes the difference in brand building, product distribution. Right from your point of manufacturing to the point of consumption, this packaging takes care of the product. So irrespective of the sensitivity of the formulation, a right combination of packaging material is chosen just to ensure that the product is safe throughout the shelf life. And from those days when we used to have those kind of mixed product in a dispensary, now consumerization happened and patient has become so comfortable sitting at home getting the product dispensed either from a blister or from a strip or from a bottle, whatever packaging form is there. So that kind of convenience is given by packaging to the patient, and that is how through lot of process changes from manual to semi-automatic to fully automatic, at various stages of operation, right from product development to the final packaging, and then material handling and storage. Everything has got a lot of automation and harmonization, standardization, and that is how the industry has stepped up to service globally. Many companies in India also, looking into the global scenario, company has started competing in those markets with the best of the product and packaging together. So question is that in our earlier group discussion, everybody was talking about teamwork, but I have not heard a single time that packaging is also a team, and that also need to be included right from the day one of product development. If the packaging scientists do not know the sensitivity of the product, whether it is heat, light or moisture sensitive, so what kind of packaging material he will choose? If you may be successful in developing the highest quality product, but if the packaging people do not know this particular product requires protection from so and so external conditions, then he will never be able to select the packaging material rightly. So include this packaging as a part of product development, and because ultimately the patient is getting the product only with your packaging, nothing else. Nobody is going to connect with them. Product is getting connected through packaging with the people. So that is why I tell that product and packaging should go together, so that your final aim to reach the people is satisfied.
To add to Prabir's statement of packaging, of course, what he rightly mentioned, it plays a very important role here. This has got a commercial aspects also, because 40% of the product cost is borne by packaging material. That's very, very important, especially when you're going in for films and foils. If the thickness is on higher side, you end up consuming a lot. So you can save a lot on that. That's what you rightly mentioned, Prabir.
Yeah, I mean, while I appreciate the discussion which has happened, the thoughts, I think some of the trends which I have seen with respect to packaging in the pharmaceutical industry are more on demographic. You find a lot of new packaging latest trends on child safe packs. You find some of the medications being packed, particularly for pediatric patients, which is quite attractive. It's like the Cadbury gems for the children. So similar type of packs are being made, and that makes the compliance for the pediatric group of patients quite easy. The second thing which I have observed is a lot of importance at the geriatric level, because it has to be an easy way to manage so as to ensure compliance. So what stems from this? I think we just started. I think what stems from this, what factors really drove the change? Is it regulatory? Is it patient needs, therapy needs, commercial needs, new distribution models, improving stability? What factors really have led to the change? Prabir,
is very right. You give least time to packaging. That is why it is in this condition. So basically, what you are telling is right, that packaging is demographically varies from region to region, and then practices, regulations, that also impact a lot to decide your packaging. Now, see, basically, we all talk about regulatory requirement, quality compliance, everything. It is nothing. You simply consider what a patient requires. If you understand that, see, all regulatory norms or quality norms are derived based on the patient's safety and security and their convenience. So all this has been given a particular shape as is part of standardization, and that we call, that set of standardization we call as rules and regulations. So that is how we comply across the industry. So now, medicines which are designed for a kid or medicine which are designed for a normal person or a senior citizen, those features are basically made considering those requirements, how a senior citizen can easily or dispense the product without facing any problem, how the medicines can be kept safely at home without the reach of the children, easy access to the children. So those kind of things came in picture just to safeguard the human society. So by mistake, it should not be used by any kids. Similarly, senior citizens also feel comfortable while using those medicines. There are features, there are many kind of value-added features also. Apart from your normal protection and prevention, rest of the all features are getting added into packaging just to add value, and that is why we call it value-added features, just to safeguard the use of the medicines. So now this latest addition like your serialization or track and trace, that is also again to safeguard the distribution and supply of the medicine, to arrest any kind of diversion, to arrest any kind of theft or similar kind of situation like counterfeiting. So all these features has become part and parcel of the packaging, because packaging along with labeling, that actually connects and communicates with the patient. So product, nobody is going to demonstrate a patient that how to use it, how to open it, how to authenticate it. So everything has to be transmitted through that packaging and labeling to the patient. So all these, while looking at the, sometimes there are graphics or mnemonics, they are used as a symbol and printed on the packaging, so that by looking at it, one can easily understand how to open it or how to use it. So those kind of features, either in the form of graphics or in the form of text, or by design, the packs are made like that so that it becomes easy for the patient to take the medicine. So this all value-added features actually for the convenience of the use.
Pradeep, can you give some examples of some of the latest packs which are there? I mean, apart from the age-old, their aluminium foils and all stuff, to blisters, to alu-alu. What are the latest trends, really?
We were touching just since, I'll give you that case example also. Since morning, I've been seeing, you know, a lot of time, Johnson & Johnson, this thing, name has come in different packaging. And I being ex-Johnsonian and privileged to tell you that one of the packs around almost 24 years back, we packed in India. See, when you export something out of the country, you have regulatory directives coming from either European authority or from US FDA. But here was the case where we have imported a very interesting drug, recombinant human erythropoietin. This is the drug which is imported for kidney transplant, so that the host should not recognize immunosuppressive drug that he is getting grafted with, foreign kidney or donor's kidney. So those days, this entire operation, just remember, this is the incidence of 1994, where you see Hyatt at Wakola now, was Johnson's warehouse, and we used to repackaging and relabeling we used to do, because the simple ampoule label, say 1 or 2 ml, or prefilled syringes, the innovative packaging what we see today in India, was those days introduced by Amgen, the world's number one biotech company. Now, I take that privilege because we had to take almost clear in seeing what today's topic is, labeling also, and see the supply chain also. A small ampoule cannot have a label of 30 to 80 mm, 30 mm width and 80 mm length. We used to have what is known as roll form label concept. Roll form meaning not I am saying adhesive roll form. the flag type label. The flag type label was introduced in those days for our pre-filled syringes, which many of the pharma companies, now this particular molecule, recombinant human erythropoietin, is now is manufactured by 2-3 pharma companies here as well. But now you see people have moved from cold forming blister in solid oral dosage form to COC, cyclic olefinic copolymer, or Aclar, which is even four times costlier than PVC. You feel like it is packed in PVC film only. But the protection barrier, as Prabir rightly said, why packaging technologist is important is, we are the one who are going to decide if the product is really moisture sensitive, hygroscopic, photosensitive, whether it needs more of the barrier properties to protect the major values in its API or bulk drug intermediate. I think that is a vital phenomenon or vital parameter one has to look into when developing the product. And that's what the latest trends are coming in the packaging norms.
So, Vinod, we have been just talking about the packaging which gets to the end consumer, the patient and all. I think there is a different area which Bilcare caters to. Can you share some thoughts on that?
Yeah, thanks, Ashokji. In fact, I am representing clinical supplies for Bilcare Limited. Clinical, as you all know, I will not go into details of that. Basically, blinding aspects are very important nowadays. This is a new area wherein we need to, you know, blind the product, maybe with respect to placebo manufacturing, clinical packaging, IWRS, storage, distribution. That plays an important role here. Clinical supplies is also very, very important because, many a times what we have seen, maybe there are commercial people sitting here. It's very important it takes around 10 to 12 years for a product to be developed and billions of dollars are spent on this. So pharma companies are looking for return on investment. And apart from that, I feel it's human value is wherein I feel being from clinical trials, there are many wonder molecules lying in the pipeline to be launched. Once they are launched, this can be a blessing to humankind. So it's very important that this area where the cost involved is very high and it should be paid attention to, because recently I'll share this, you can also correlate this with your pharma manufacturing where, you know, USFDA inspection normally happens. We were at one of the sites where the USFDA inspector was, you know, auditing us. The auditor was 6 feet tall. She was taller than me. In fact, because, you know, as you go there to face the auditor itself is a phobia. She did ask about placebo manufacturing, clinical packaging, IWRS. We could answer all the queries. But in the end, and she did question in about all the, you know, gel pack conditioning, temtail devices, how it was handled. So to that extent, people go. So my only request is to all the stakeholders, they should be very well aware of, and training is very important in that case. Everybody down the line should be trained, because these new generation inspectors are very well versed with technicalities and they can question anything. And off the track, since we don't have much time, being from clinical trials, I like to highlight here is, as somebody mentioned in the morning, artificial intelligence is definitely, it's a revolution now. When we are talking today, I can say that many of you must be knowing that today the pizzas are getting delivered by drone in New Zealand. I think that day is not far where the medicines also will be delivered. One of the very good examples, I think you must be knowing about famous Hollywood actress Angelina Jolie. She got her both the breast removed, operated, and then two ovaries were also removed 2 years later, only because, you know, her mother, her grandmother and her auntie was having breast and ovarian cancer. So she predicted that, and she, you know, got her genes mapped. So that's the genomics. So that's a new field wherein, you know, people can get the precise medicine. And this is going to be a boom for next generation. Apart from that, now, you know, you have joints getting replaced, heart walls are getting replaced. But now days are not very far where the tissues will be injected, you know, like a person who's diabetic, your tissues will be removed, they will be injected with the required insulin, and it will be again reprogrammed. So that's the future of medicine. And I request, since the persons are there from academics, AI is the next generation thing which people need to include in their curriculum. Thank you very much.
Okay, coming back to track, packaging is extremely important, because that's the last thing that happens at the factory of a pharmaceutical company, right? That really gives or builds the image at the retail shelf or wherever at the patient's house. That gives the image. It's like wearing a suit, and that's what packaging is all about. So coming back to track, is packaging is extremely important. And the latest trends in packaging are in terms of patient reminder packs, where the patient gets a bip that it's time for you to take your medication. It's there are different other patient reminder packs which are there, which helps to ensure compliance. So it's another, I mean, morning we started with what are the key strategic initiatives that pharma companies will be taking. Packaging is one of those key initiatives that pharma companies or the pharma industry will be looking for the future.
Sir, can I add a point to it? Actually, we talked about a lot of stakeholders around us. I always say in my company, and in general, whenever I speak India or abroad, I say, in fact, the packaging people are just like a sun in the orbit. Why? Other people revolve. With due respect to all of you, please don't mind my language. My intention of telling is, we have regulatory people, IP people, everyone. See, we are the people who even decide the product registration through our legal department. Because when you register your brand in Indian market for packaging, it is always you see, even you see Augmentin or Unienzyme, any brand you take, a prominent brand of Crocin or even your Combiflam, you will see something marked like R or asterisk. What is that it means? It means that you are declaring on your labeling that the trademark is under registration, or it is R is a registered trademark. It is not only that. You go with the regulatory agency, you are attached to commercial, you are attached to purchase people, you are international logistics, you are with QA, QC, production, engineering. You tell me which are the department which are left out without connecting to the packaging people or the packaging development people. So I feel we always proudly share the role of a sun in the orbit to interact, coordinate, and support. That's my view on this topic. Thank you so much.
Right.
Can we have a lot of applause for these gentlemen, everybody? Well, it seems we have just one question from this gentleman over here. So,
this is with respect to DGFT notification and CDSCO notification about the placing barcode on primary packaging along with human readable format. So currently, the notification is postponed, given time for another 1 year. So can you throw some light on this? How can we achieve this on the small vial, both human readable as well as barcode? The barcode should contain manufacturing date, expiry date, MRP, licensing, company name. Can you show any thoughts?
Right now, I think notification what has come, it is not very elaborately written. It is giving both kind of data they have mentioned. Fixed data as well as variable data. Normally, your fixed data is your product name, brand name, your label claim, storage condition, license number, address. These are all fixed data. And the other part is your variable data. And that contains your lot number, manufacturing date, expiry. And they have also not clarified. They have just simply written that it will be a QR code. So whether that QR code is of GS1 standard or what? What is the basic element? The sentence is not written very clearly, so some ambiguity is there. That is why a lot of industry feedback has been given to the ministry, and that is the reason it has been given to 1 year extension, just to get more clarification. So mostly it is related to variable information, what is required so that people can get access, or give it a fixed information. Both can be added together, but that technology till now is not available to connect both and then communicate through external wireless communication.
To the August panel, I have small questions. Pradeep sir?
Yeah.
As a layman in the packaging, I would like to know, are we still using aluminum foil?
Yeah, very much.
Okay, one minute. Yeah. That's what I want to know. Once having said that, aluminum is being used. Today, if you look at some of the aspects of cognition and other, you know, dementia, if you want to produce an Alzheimer's model, it is aluminum which is being injected, actually. And we, even in Dadima, may not be using that time banana leaf or many other things. Today, when we do anything, breakfast or this thing, it is being packed in a just. Are you getting me what I say?
Yeah.
We are trying to use this aluminum foil to the level that is, and we feel, oh, it's beautifully served. Actually, it is neurotoxic to begin with. This aluminum foil, as more and more we dip into nutraceutical items and dietary supplements into it, it is over a period of time is going to be toxic. That's what I want to know.
I'm a lay person in this area, but from my common sense and after looking at some of these packs, what you are referring to is packs of cereals, cornflakes and things like that, which are packed. But only thing is that it is not in direct contact with the aluminium. So there is an inside foil which covers and prevents the food articles to be in direct contact with the aluminium. So maybe world over it's like that. So yeah, just to get back to your answer, the DCGI has clearly mentioned that if you have issues with it, bring it to me. The OPPI, the IDMA, and IPA are all presenting papers to the DCGI in terms of the QR coding. But from the heart of each one of us know, it's a bold step, it's a very good step. It should have been taken much earlier than it's coming, but better late than never. I think I would like to end this discussion. Mr. Pradeep, I really appreciate your passion for what you do. On a holistic side, every department in the company is equally important. You cannot function. It's all interdependence. You cannot function one without the other. So all are of equal importance as such. And I think whatever we do, we are in the healthcare industry. We are discussing about healthcare. Let us look at how do we touch the lives, be proud of touching the lives of patients and making them smile. I think that is the biggest thing that we can contribute working in a pharmaceutical sector to the nation. So thank you. Sorry for very poor time management from my side. I apologize.
Well, some interesting topics can definitely be given a leeway, sir. Thank you so much. Can we have a round of applause for these gentlemen, everybody? Especially for Mr. Bhattacharya for waiting for so long for his session. Well, I request over here Ms. Mitali to please join us on the stage and felicitate Mr. Vinod Mulay with a certificate of appreciation. Can we have a round of applause, everybody? Thank you for joining us today, sir. One more. Thank you so much. Can we have the certificate of appreciation for Mr. Pradeep Dhargalkar, please? Round of applause, everybody. Let me tell you, sir had told me before the session that they're going to be sitting separately in a panel and discussing so that, you know, they can get the best of the topics for this session. So, sir, it was definitely interesting. Very well done. Thank you so much. I request over here, Mitali ma'am, to please felicitate Mr. Prabir Das over here with a certificate of appreciation. Thank you so much, gentlemen. It was a pleasure having you. Please be seated. The session is still to end. Few more sessions to go. Well, for the
that product and packaging should go together so that your final aim to reach the people is satisfied.
To add to Prabir's statement of packaging, of course, what he rightly mentioned, it plays a very important role here. This has got a commercial aspects also, because 40% of the product cost is borne by packaging material. That's very, very important, especially when you're going in for films and foils. If the thickness is on higher side, you end up consuming a lot. So you can save a lot on that. That's what you rightly mentioned, Prabir.
Yeah, I mean, while I appreciate the discussion which has happened, the thoughts, I think some of the trends which I have seen with respect to packaging in the pharmaceutical industry are more on demographic. You find a lot of new packaging latest trends on child safe packs. You find some of the medications being packed, particularly for pediatric patients, which is quite attractive. It's like the Cadbury gems for the children. So similar type of packs are being made. And that makes the compliance for the pediatric group of patients quite easy. The second thing which I have observed is a lot of importance at the geriatric level, because it has to be an easy way to manage so as to ensure compliance. So what stems from this? I think we just started. I think what stems from this, what factors really drove the change? Is it regulatory? Is it patient needs, therapy needs, commercial needs, new distribution models, improving stability? What factors really have led to the change?
It's very right. You give least time to packaging. That is why it is in this condition. So basically, what you are telling is right, that packaging is demographically varies from region to region. And then practices, regulations, that also impact a lot to decide your packaging. Now, see, basically, we all talk about regulatory requirement, quality compliance, everything. It is nothing. You simply consider what a patient requires. If you understand that, see, all regulatory norms or quality norms are derived based on the patient's safety and security and their convenience. So all this has been given a particular shape as this part of standardization, and that we call, that set of standardization we call as rules and regulations. So that is how we comply across the industry. So now, medicines which are designed for a kid, or medicine which are designed for a normal person or a senior citizen, those features are basically made considering those requirements, how a senior citizen can easily or dispense the product without facing any problem, how the medicines can be kept safely at home without the reach of the children, easy access to the children. So those kind of things came in picture just to safeguard the human society. So by mistake, it should not be used by any kids. Similarly, senior citizens also feel comfortable while using those medicines. There are features, there are many kind of value-added features also. Apart from your normal protection and prevention, rest of the all features are getting added into packaging just to add value, and that is why we call it value-added features, just to safeguard the use of the medicines. So now this latest addition, like your serialization or track and trace, that is also again to safeguard the distribution and supply of the medicine, to arrest any kind of diversion, to arrest any kind of theft or similar kind of situation like counterfeiting. So all these features has become part and parcel of the packaging, because packaging along with labeling, that actually connects and communicates with the patient. So product, nobody is going to demonstrate a patient that how to use it, how to open it, how to authenticate it. So everything has to be transmitted through that packaging and labeling to the patient. So all these, while looking at the, sometimes there are graphics or mnemonics, they are used as a symbol and printed on the packaging, so that by looking at it, one can easily understand how to open it or how to use it. So those kind of features, either in the form of graphics or in the form of text, or by design, the packs are made like that so that it becomes easy for the patient to take the medicine. So this all value-added features actually for the convenience of the use.
Pradeep, can you give some examples of some of the latest packs which are there? I mean, apart from the age-old, their aluminium foils and all stuff, to blisters, to alu-alu. What are the latest trends, really?
We were touching just since, I'll give you that case example also. Since morning, I've been seeing, you know, a lot of time, Johnson & Johnson, this thing, name has come in different packaging. And I being ex-Johnsonian and privileged to tell you that one of the packs around almost 24 years back, we packed in India. See, when you export something out of the country, you have regulatory directives coming from either European authority or from US FDA. But here was the case where we have imported a very interesting drug, recombinant human erythropoietin. This is the drug which is imported for kidney transplant, so that the host should not recognize immunosuppressive drug, that he is getting grafted with foreign kidney or donor's kidney. So those days, this entire operation, just remember, this is the incidence of 1994, where you see Hyatt at Wakola now, was Johnson's warehouse, and we used to repackaging and relabeling we used to do, because the simple ampoule label, say 1 or 2 ml, or prefilled syringes, the innovative packaging what we see today in India, was those days introduced by Amgen, the world's number one biotech company. Now, I take that privilege because we had to take almost clear in seeing what today's topic is, labeling also, and see the supply chain also. A small ampoule cannot have a label of 30 to 80 mm, 30 mm width and 80 mm length. We used to have what is known as roll form label concept. Roll form meaning not I am saying adhesive roll form. The flag type label. The flag type label was introduced in those days for our pre-filled syringes, which many of the pharma companies, now this particular molecule, recombinant human erythropoietin, is now is manufactured by 2-3 pharma companies here as well. But now you see people have moved from cold forming blister in solid oral dosage form to COC, cyclic olefinic copolymer, or Aclar, which is even 4 times costlier than PVC. You feel like it is packed in PVC film only. But the protection barrier, as Prabir rightly said, why packaging technologist is important is, we are the one who are going to decide if the product is really moisture sensitive, hygroscopic, photosensitive, whether it needs more of the barrier properties to protect the major values in its API or bulk drug intermediate. I think that is a vital phenomenon or vital parameter one has to look into when developing the product. And that's what the latest trends are coming in the packaging norms.
So, Vinod, we have been just talking about the packaging, which gets to the end consumer, the patient and all. I think there is a different area which Bilcare caters to. Can you share some thoughts on that?
Yeah, thanks, Ashokji. In fact, I am representing clinical supplies for Bilcare Limited. Clinical, as you all know, I'll not go into details of that. Basically, blinding aspects are very important nowadays. This is a new area wherein we need to, you know, blind the product, maybe with respect to placebo manufacturing, clinical packaging, IWRS, storage, distribution. That plays an important role here. Clinical supplies is also very, very important because, many a times what we have seen, maybe there are commercial people sitting here. It's very important since it takes around 10 to 12 years for a product to be developed and billions of dollars are spent on this. So pharma companies are looking for return on investment. And apart from that, I feel it's human value is wherein I feel being from clinical trials, there are many wonder molecules lying in the pipeline to be launched. Once they are launched, this can be a blessing to humankind. So it's very important that this area where the cost involved is very high and it should be paid attention to, because recently I'll share this, you can also correlate this with your pharma manufacturing where, you know, USFDA inspection normally happens. We were at one of the sites where the USFDA inspector was, you know, auditing us. The auditor was 6 feet tall. She was taller than me. In fact, because, you know, as you go there to face the auditor itself is a phobia. She did ask about placebo manufacturing, clinical packaging, IWRS. We could answer all the queries. But in the end, to our surprise, she also called the service provider, logistics person who bought the Credo box in. And she did question in about all the, you know, gel pack conditioning, temtail devices, how it was handled. So to that extent, people go. So my only request is to all the stakeholders, they should be very well aware of, and training is very important in that case. Everybody down the line should be trained, because these new generation inspectors are very well versed with technicalities and they can question anything. And off the track, since we don't have much time, being from clinical trials, I like to highlight here is, as somebody mentioned in the morning, artificial intelligence is definitely, it's a revolution now. When we are talking today, I can say that many of you must be knowing that today the pizzas are getting delivered by drone in New Zealand. I think that day is not far where the medicines also will be delivered. One of the very good examples, I think you must be knowing about famous Hollywood actress Angelina Jolie. She got her both the breast removed, operated, and then two ovaries were also removed 2 years later, only because, you know, her mother, her grandmother and her auntie was having breast and ovarian cancer. So she predicted that, and she, you know, got her genes mapped. So that's the genomics. So that's a new field wherein, you know, people can get the precise medicine. And this is going to be a boom for next generation. Apart from that, now, you know, you have joints getting replaced, heart walls are getting replaced. But now days are not very far where the tissues will be injected. You know, like a person who's diabetic, your tissues will be removed. They will be, injected with the required insulin, and it will be again, reprogrammed. So that's the future of medicine. And I request, since the persons are there from academics, AI is the next generation thing which people need to include in their curriculum. Thank you very much.
Okay, coming back to track, packaging is extremely important because that's the last thing that happens at the factory of a pharmaceutical company, right? That really gives or builds the image at the retail shelf or wherever at the patient's house. That gives the image. It's like wearing a suit, and that's what packaging is all about. So coming back to track, packaging is extremely important. And the latest trends in packaging are in terms of patient reminder packs, where the patient gets a bip that it's time for you to take your medication. It's there are different other patient reminder packs which are there. which helps to ensure compliance. So it's another, I mean, morning we started with what are the key strategic initiatives that pharma companies will be taking. Packaging is one of those key initiatives that pharma companies or the pharma industry is will be looking for the future.
Sir, can I add the point to it? Actually, we talked about a lot of stakeholders around us. I always say in my company, and in general, whenever I speak India or abroad, I say, in fact, the packaging people are just like a sun in the orbit. Why? Other people revolve. With due respect to all of you, please don't mind my language. My intention of telling is we have regulatory people, IP people, everyone. See, we are the people who even decide the product registration through our legal department. Because when you register your brand in Indian market for packaging, it is always you see, even you see Augmentin or Unienzyme. Any brand you take, a prominent brand of Crocin or even your Combiflam, you will see something marked like R or asterisk. What is that it means? It means that you are declaring on your labeling that the trademark is under registration or it is R is a registered trademark. It is not only that. You go with the regulatory agency, you are attached to commercial, you are attached to purchase people, you are international logistics, you are with QA, QC, production, engineering. You tell me which are the department which are left out without connecting to the packaging people or the packaging development people. So yeah. I feel we always proudly share the role of a sun in the orbit to interact, coordinate and support. That's my view on this topic. Thank you so much.
Right.
Can we have a lot of applause for these gentlemen, everybody? Well, it seems we have just one question from this gentleman over here. So.
This is with respect to DGFT notification and CDSCO notification about the placing barcode on primary packaging along with human readable format. So currently the notification is postponed given time for another 1 year. So can you throw some light on this? How can we achieve this on the small vial, both human readable as well as barcode? The barcode should contain manufacturing date, expiry date, MRP, licensing, company name. Can you show us, can you show any thoughts?
Right now, I think notification what has come, it is not very elaborately written. It is giving both kind of data they have mentioned. Fixed data as well as variable data. Normally, your fixed data is your product name, brand name, your label claim, storage condition, license number, address. These are all fixed data. And the other part is your variable data. And that contains your lot number, manufacturing date, expiry. And they have also not clarified. They have just simply written that it will be a QR code. So whether that QR code is of GS1 standard or what? What is the basic element? The sentence is not written very clearly, so some ambiguity is there. That is why a lot of industry feedback has been given to the ministry, and that is the reason it has been given to 1 year extension, just to get more clarification. So mostly it is related to variable information, what is required, so that people can get access. Or give it a fixed information. Both can be added together, but that technology till now is not available to connect both and then communicate through external wireless communication.
To the August panel, I have small questions. Pradeep sir?
Yeah.
As a layman in the packaging, I would like to know, are we still using aluminum foil?
Yeah, very much.
Okay, one minute. Yeah. That's what I want to know. Once having said that, aluminum is being used. Today, if you look at some of the aspects of cognition and other, you know, dementia, if you want to produce an Alzheimer's model, it is aluminum which is being injected. Actually, and we, even Dadima, may not be using that time banana leaf or many other things today. When we do anything, breakfast or this thing, it is being packed in a chest. Are you getting me what I say?
Yeah.
We are trying to use this aluminum foil to the level that is, and we feel, oh, it's beautifully served. Actually, it is neurotoxic to begin with. This aluminum foil, as more and more we dip into nutraceutical items and dietary supplements into it, it is over a period of time is going to be toxic. That's what I want to know.
I'm a lay person in this area, but from my common sense and after looking at some of these packs, what you are referring to is packs of cereals, cornflakes and things like that, which are packed. But only thing is that it is not in direct contact with the aluminium. So there is an inside foil which covers and prevents the food articles to be in direct contact with the aluminium. So maybe world over it's like that. So yeah, that's just to get back to your answer. The DCGI has clearly mentioned that if you have issues with it, bring it to me. The OPPI, the IDMA, and IPA are all presenting papers to the DCGI in terms of the QR coding. But from the heart of each one of us know, it's a bold step, it's a very good step. It should have been taken much earlier than it's coming, but better late than never. I think I would like to end this discussion. Mr. Pradeep, I really appreciate your passion for what you do. On a holistic side, every department in the company is equally important. You cannot function. It's all interdependence. You cannot function one with the, without the other. So all are of equal importance as such. And I think whatever we do, we are in the healthcare industry. We are discussing about healthcare. Let us look at how do we touch the lives, be proud of touching the lives of patients and making them smile. I think that is the biggest thing that we can contribute working in a pharmaceutical sector to the nation. So thank you. Sorry for very poor time management from my side. I apologize.
Well, some interesting topics can definitely be given a leeway, sir. Thank you so much. Can we have a round of applause for these gentlemen, everybody? Especially for Mr. Bhattacharya for waiting for so long for his session. Well, I request over here Ms. Mitali to please join us on the stage and felicitate Mr. Vinod Mulay with a certificate of appreciation. Can we have a round of applause, everybody? Thank you for joining us today, sir.
Wait, one more.
Can we? Thank you so much. Can we have the certificate of appreciation for Mr. Pradeep Dhargalkar, please? Round of applause, everybody. Let me tell you, sir had told me before the session that they are going to be sitting separately in a panel and discussing so that, you know, they can get the best of the topics for this session. So, sir, it was definitely interesting. Very well done. Thank you so much. I request over here, Mitali ma'am, to please felicitate Mr. Prabir Das over here with a certificate of appreciation. Thank you so much, gentlemen. It was a pleasure having you. Please be seated. The session is still to end. Few more sessions to go. Well, for the...
That product and packaging should go together so that your final aim to reach the people is satisfied.
To add to Prabir's statement of packaging, of course, what he rightly mentioned, it plays a very important role here. This has got a commercial aspects also, because 40% of the product cost is borne by packaging material. That's very, very important, especially when you're going in for films and foils. If the thickness is on higher side, you end up consuming a lot. So you can save a lot on that. That's what you rightly mentioned, Prabir.
I appreciate the discussion which has happened, the thoughts. I think some of the trends which I have seen with respect to packaging in the pharmaceutical industry are more on demographic. You find a lot of new packaging latest trends on child safe packs. You find some of the medications being packed, particularly for pediatric patients, which is quite attractive. It's like the Cadbury gems for the children. So similar type of packs are being made, and that makes the compliance for the pediatric group of patients quite easy. The second thing which I have observed is a lot of importance at the geriatric level, because it has to be an easy way to manage so as to ensure compliance. So what stems from this? I think we just started. Okay. I think what stems from this, what factors really drove the change? Is it regulatory? Is it patient needs, therapy needs, commercial needs, new distribution models, improving stability? What factors really have led to the change? Prabir,
is very right. You give least time to packaging. That is why it is in this condition. So basically, what you are telling is right, that packaging is demographically varies from region to region. And then practices, regulations, that also impact a lot to decide your packaging. Now, see, basically, we all talk about regulatory requirement, quality compliance, everything. It is nothing. You simply consider what a patient requires. If you understand that, see, all regulatory norms or quality norms are derived based on the patient's safety and security and their convenience. So all this has been given a particular shape as is part of standardization, and that we call, that set of standardization we call as rules and regulations. So that is how we comply across the industry. So now, medicines which are designed for a kid, or medicine which are designed for a normal person or a senior citizen, those features are basically made considering those requirements, how a senior citizen can easily or dispense the product without facing any problem, how the medicines can be kept safely at home without the reach of the children, easy access to the children. So those kind of things came in picture just to safeguard the human society. So by mistake, it should not be used by any kids. Similarly, senior citizens also feel comfortable while using those medicines. There are features, there are many kind of value-added features also. Apart from your normal protection and prevention, rest of the all features are getting added into packaging just to add value, and that is why we call it value-added features, just to safeguard the use of the medicines. So now this latest addition, like your serialization or track and trace, that is also again to safeguard the distribution and supply of the medicine, to arrest any kind of diversion, to arrest any kind of theft or similar kind of situation like counterfeiting. So all these features has become part and parcel of the packaging, because packaging along with labeling, that actually connects and communicates with the patient. So product, nobody is going to demonstrate a patient that how to use it, how to open it, how to authenticate it. So everything has to be transmitted through that packaging and labeling to the patient. So all this, while looking at the, sometimes there are graphics or mnemonics, they are used as a symbol and printed on the packaging, so that by looking at it, one can easily understand how to open it or how to use it. So those kind of features either in the form of graphics or in the form of text, or by design the packs are made like that so that it becomes easy for the patient to take the medicine. So this all value-added features actually for the convenience of the use.
Pradeep, can you give some examples of some of the latest packs which are there? I mean, apart from the age-old, their aluminium foils and all stuff, to blisters, to alu-alu. What are the latest trends, really?
We were touching just since, I'll give you that case example also. Since morning, I've been seeing, you know, a lot of time, Johnson & Johnson, this thing, name has come in different packaging. And I being ex-Johnsonian and privileged to tell you that one of the packs around almost 24 years back, we packed in India. See, when you export something out of the country, you have regulatory directives coming from either European authority or from US FDA. But here was the case where we have imported a very interesting drug, recombinant human erythropoietin. This is the drug which is imported for kidney transplant so that the host should not recognize immunosuppressive drug that he is getting grafted with foreign kidney or donor's kidney. So those days, this entire operation, just remember this is the incidence of 1994, where you see Hyatt at Wakola now, was Johnson's warehouse, and we used to repackaging and relabeling we used to do because the simple ampoule label, say 1 or 2 ml, or pre-filled syringes, the innovative packaging what we see today in India, was those days introduced by Amgen, the world's number one biotech company. Now, I take that privilege because we had to take almost clear in seeing what today's topic is, labeling also, and see the supply chain also. A small ampoule cannot have a label of 30 to 80 mm, 30 mm width and 80 mm length. We used to have what is known as roll form label concept. Roll form meaning not I am saying adhesive roll form. The flag type label. The flag type label was introduced in those days for our pre-filled syringes, which many of the pharma companies, now this particular molecule, recombinant human erythropoietin, is now is manufactured by 2-3 pharma companies here as well. But now you see people have moved from cold forming blister in solid oral dosage form to COC, cyclic olefinic copolymer, or Aclar, which is even 4 times costlier than PVC. You feel like it is packed in PVC film only. But the protection barrier, as Prabir rightly said, why packaging technologist is important is, we are the one who are going to decide if the product is really moisture sensitive, hygroscopic, photosensitive, whether it needs more of the barrier properties to protect the major values in its API or bulk drug intermediate. I think that is a vital phenomenon or vital parameter one has to look into when developing the product. And that's what the latest trends are coming in the packaging norms.
So, Vinod, we have been just talking about the packaging which gets to the end consumer, the patient and all. I think there is a different area which Bilcare caters to. Can you share some thoughts on that?
Yeah, thanks, Ashokji. In fact, I am representing clinical supplies for Bilcare Limited. Clinical, as you all know, I'll not go into details of that. Basically, blinding aspects are very important nowadays. This is a new area wherein we need to, blind the product, maybe with respect to placebo manufacturing, clinical packaging, IWRS, storage, distribution, that plays an important role here. Clinical supplies is also very, very important because many a times what we have seen, maybe there are commercial people sitting here, it's very important they, it takes around 10 to 12 years for a product to be developed and billions of dollars are spent on this. So pharma companies are looking for return on investment. And apart from that, I feel it's human value is wherein I feel being from clinical trials, there are many wonder molecules lying in the pipeline to be launched.
once they are launched, this can be a blessing to humankind. So it's very important that this area where the cost involved is very high, and it should be paid attention to, because recently I'll share this, can you can also correlate this with your pharma manufacturing, where, you know, USFDA inspection normally happens. We were at one of the sites where the USFDA inspector was, you know, auditing us. The auditor was 6 feet tall. She was taller than me, in fact, because, you know, as you go there to face the auditor itself is a phobia. She did ask about placebo manufacturing, clinical packaging, IWRS. We could answer all the queries. And to our surprise, she also called the service provider, logistics person who bought the Credo box in. And she did question in about all the, you know, gel pack conditioning, temtail devices, how it was handled. So to that extent, people go. So my only request is to all the stakeholders, they should be very well aware of, and training is very important in that case. Everybody down the line should be trained, because these new generation inspectors are very well versed with technicalities, and they can question anything. And off the track, since we don't have much time, being from clinical trials, I like to highlight here is, you know, as somebody mentioned in the morning, artificial intelligence is definitely, you know, it's a revolution now. When we are talking today, I can say that many of you must be knowing that today the pizzas are getting delivered by drone in New Zealand. I think that day is not far where the medicines also will be delivered. One of the very good examples, I think you must be knowing about famous Hollywood actress Angelina Jolie. She got her both the breasts removed, operated. And then two ovaries were also removed 2 years later. Only because, you know, her mother, her grandmother and her auntie was having breast and ovarian cancer. So she predicted that, and she, you know, got her genes mapped. So that's the genomics. So that's a new field wherein, you know, people can get the precise medicine. And this is going to be a boom for next generation. Apart from that, now, you know, you have joints getting replaced, heart walls are getting replaced. But now days are not very far where the tissues will be injected. You know, like a person who's diabetic, your tissues will be removed. They will be, you know, injected with the required insulin, and it will be again, you know, reprogrammed. So that's the future of medicine. And I request, since the persons are there from academics, AI is the next generation thing which people need to include in their curriculum. Thank you very much.
Okay, coming back to track, packaging is extremely important, because that's the last thing that happens at the factory of a pharmaceutical company, right? That really gives or builds the image at the retail shelf or wherever at the patient's house. That gives the image. It's like wearing a suit, and that's what packaging is all about. So coming back to track, is packaging is extremely important. And the latest trends in packaging are in terms of patient reminder packs, where the patient gets a bip that it's time for you to take your medication. It's there are different other patient reminder packs which are there, which helps to ensure compliance. So it's another, I mean, morning we started with what are the key strategic initiatives that pharma companies will be taking. Packaging is one of those key initiatives that pharma companies or the pharma industry is will be looking for the future.
Sir, can I add the point to it? Actually, we talked about a lot of stakeholders around us. I always say in my company, and in general, whenever I speak India or abroad, I say, in fact, the packaging people are just like a sun in the orbit. Why? Other people's revolve. With due respect to all of you, please don't mind my language. My intention of telling is, we have regulatory people, IP people, everyone. See, we are the people who even decide the product registration through our legal department. Because when you register your brand in Indian market for packaging, it is always you see, even you see Augmentin or Unienzyme, any brand you take, a prominent brand of Crocin or even your Combiflam, you will see something marked like R or asterisk. What is that it means? It means that you are declaring on your labeling that the trademark is under registration or it is R is a registered trademark. It is not only that. You go with the regulatory agency, you are attached to commercial, you are attached to purchase people, you are international logistics, you are with QA, QC, production, engineering. You tell me which are the department which are left out without connecting to the packaging people or the packaging development people. So I feel we always proudly share the role of a sun in the orbit to interact, coordinate and support. That's my view on this topic. Thank you so much.
Right.
Can we have a lot of applause for these gentlemen, everybody? Well, it seems we have just one question from this gentleman over here. So.
This is with respect to DGFT notification and CDSCO notification about the placing barcode on primary packaging along with human readable format. So currently the notification is postponed given time for another 1 year. So can you throw some light on this? How can we achieve this on the small vial, both human readable as well as barcode? The barcode should contain manufacturing date, expiry date, MRP, licensing, company name. Can you show any thoughts?
Right now, I think notification what has come, it is not very elaborately written. It is giving both kind of data they have mentioned. Fixed data as well as variable data. Normally, your fixed data is your product name, brand name, your label claim, storage condition, license number, address. These are all fixed data. And the other part is your variable data. And that contains your lot number, manufacturing date, expiry. And they have also not clarified. They have just simply written that it will be a QR code. So whether that QR code is of GS1 standard or what is the basic element? The sentence is not written very clearly, so some ambiguity is there. That is why a lot of industry feedback has been given to the ministry, and that is the reason it has been given to 1 year extension, just to get more clarification. So mostly it is related to variable information, what is required, so that people can get access. Or give it a fixed information. Both can be added together, but that technology till now is not available to connect both and then communicate through external wireless communication.
To the August panel, I have small questions. Pradeep sir?
Yeah.
As a layman in the packaging, I would like to know, are we still using aluminum foil?
Yeah, very much.
Okay, one minute. Yeah. That's what I want to know. Once having said that, aluminum is being used. Today, if you look at some of the aspects of cognition and other, you know, dementia, if you want to produce an Alzheimer's model, it is aluminum which is being injected. Actually, and we, even Dadima, may not be using that time banana leaf or many other things today. When we do anything, breakfast or this thing, it is being packed in a chest. Are you getting me what I say?
Yeah.
We are trying to use this aluminum foil to the level that is, and we feel, oh, it's beautifully served. Actually, it is neurotoxic to begin with, this aluminum foil. As more and more we dip into nutraceutical items and dietary supplements into it, it is over a period of time is going to be toxic. That's what I want.
I'm a lay person in this area, but from my common sense and after looking at some of these packs, what you are referring to is packs of cereals, cornflakes and things like that, which are packed. But only thing is that it is not in direct contact with the aluminium. So there is an inside foil which covers and prevents the food articles to be in direct contact with the aluminium. So maybe world over it's like that. Yeah. So yeah, that's just to get back to your answer. The DCGI has clearly mentioned that if you have issues with it, bring it to me. The OPPI, the IDMA, and IPA are all presenting papers to the DCGI in terms of the QR coding. But from the heart, each one of us know it's a bold step. It's a very good step. It should have been taken much earlier than it's coming, but better late than never. I think I would like to end this discussion. Mr. Pradeep, I really appreciate your passion for what you do. On a holistic side, every department in the company is equally important. You cannot function. It's all interdependence. You cannot function one with the, without the other. So all are of equal importance as such. And I think whatever we do, we are in the healthcare industry. We are discussing about healthcare. Let us look at how do we touch the lives, be proud of touching the lives of patients and making them smile. I think that is the biggest thing that we can contribute working in a pharmaceutical sector to the nation. So thank you. Sorry for very poor time management from my side. I apologize.
Well, some interesting topics can definitely be given a leeway, sir. Thank you so much. Can we have a round of applause for these gentlemen, everybody? Especially for Mr. Bhattacharya for waiting for so long for his session. Well, I request over here Ms. Mitali to please join us on the stage and felicitate Mr. Vinod Mulay with a certificate of appreciation. Can we have a round of applause, everybody? Thank you for joining us today, sir. Thank you so much. Can we have the certificate of appreciation for Mr. Pradeep Dhargalkar, please? Round of applause, everybody. Let me tell you, sir had told me before the session that they are going to be sitting separately in a panel and discussing so that, you know, they can get the best of the topics for this session. So, sir, it was definitely interesting. Very well done. Thank you so much. I request over here, Mitali ma'am, to please felicitate Mr. Prabir Das over here with a certificate of appreciation. Thank you so much, gentlemen. It was a pleasure having you. Please be seated. The session is still to end. Few more sessions to go. Well, for the...